to you. It's times like these that I feel so small. There must be something I can do. I played it safe in shallow water. Never had the faith to cross the border. God, I've gotten good at being comfortable. It's time to leave my comfort zone. 'Cause you said go. This light is like a candle that you gave us to burn. God, we wanna light up the night. Instead of living without, we should be living it out. To let your love be magnified. 'Cause you said go.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the midweek Bible study. Thank you for being here. We are going to study the word tonight, but we are also going to baptize new believers. How great is that? Amen. Let's stand to your feet, and we're going to sing a worship song real quick. Amen. Here's one from Jesus Culture tonight. There's a space.
There's a space in every beating heart. There's a longing that reaches past the stars. There's an answer to every question mark. There's a name. There's a hope flowing through these veins. There's a voice that echoes through the pain. There's an ember ready for the flame. There's a name. We will fix our eyes on the one who will stand in awe of the one who breaks the chains. Love has a name. Love has a name. Jesus. Love has a name. Love has a name. Jesus. There's a joy that triumphs over fear. There's a laughter that wipes away all tears. There's a presence that changes atmospheres. There's a name.
Who there's a name.
We'll fix our eyes on the one who overcame. We will stand in awe of the one who breaks. a name. Love has a name. Jesus. Love has a name. Love has a name. Jesus.
Victory.
Victory has a name. Victory has a name. Jesus.
Joy.
Joy has a name. Joy.
Love has a name, And his name is the name above all names, the hope of glory. Our victory is in Jesus. Somebody give him a shout of praise tonight. Hallelujah. Pastor Tim, would you pray us in tonight? God bless.
Dear God, we just come before your presence, God. Lord, we come giving you thanks, honor, and praise, God. God, we're so glad that your love has a name. And that name is Jesus. The name that is above every name, God. That at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, God. And every tongue shall confess that you are Lord, to the glory of God, Lord. God, we come gathering in this place, God, just to uplift your name, God. We ask that you would take control of this service, God. Have your way, God. Move any way you desire tonight in this place, God. If it be anyone in this room that don't know you or online, God, we ask that you would touch their hearts, that they may come to know you in the pardon of their sins. Bless our man of God as he released your word on tonight, God. God, may some lost soul, God, some dying soul, God, may come to know you in the pardon of their sins, God. God, we thank you for the candidates that are going to get baptized tonight, God. We thank you, God, for the step that they made, God, the step of faith. Accepting your son, Jesus, knowing that they are rejoicing in heaven, God. We're so thankful, God, for everything that you're going to do in our midst. We say, do it for your glory. And we'll be so ever careful to give you the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. For it's in the matchless name of Jesus we pray, and the church said.
Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you again for being here. We're going to go over some quick announcements. I need to see them, guys. Our printer's been down this week. We've had some office issues. All right, our 2020 Empowerment Conference. Anybody heard about that? It is coming. Kingdom Vision. It is on like a chicken bone after lunch on Sunday, Wednesday night too. Amen. September 13th through the 16th. And we said this, and I believe it's true. This is the biggest lineup ever. So you really want to make plans to be there. CFC World Missions Local Outreach on September 19th. You can see Billy Joe Hopkins about that. That's a chance to minister out on the streets. Information about life groups, men's, ladies, and senior ministries will be announced soon. In fact, it'll be announced this Sunday. We're going to let everybody know what we're doing as far as all that goes, okay? All right. And so, again, thank you guys for being here. We're going to get ready to dismiss the kids that are in here, the King's Kids and the Fusion youth group. But, guys, you won't be gone long. Are they already gone? They're already gone? Okay, they're already out of here. All right. I don't know if they're coming back in here for the baptism. We'd love to have them back. What's that? Okay. You got one right there? All right. Amen. Got some. Okay, good. I didn't know what was going on. I don't have my glasses on. I can't see everybody. I'm blind as a bat. Amen. Mm-hmm. I need all the help I can get. Amen. All right. Are we good then? Okay. They can go ahead and then we're going to get ready for the word. Anybody want to hear the word? We get done with this. We'll go over prayer requests. We'll go over prayer requests. And if you're watching online tonight, which I hope you are, especially if you're not able to be here tonight, put your prayer request in the chat there, and we will call it out loud when we do the prayer request in just a moment. But I know we've got to baptize, but can we read a little bit of the Bible first? Amen? Is that all right? Let's go to Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. Right. We'll get through this, and then we'll have prayer requests, and then we'll baptize, and we'll send you on your way, amen. But this is important. How many agree with that? How many know the Word of God is so important? Amen? So important. We need the Word so bad, especially in the time we are living in now, where people are literally trying to rewrite the Bible. And we cannot have that. You know why? God said don't do it. He said don't add a single thing to it. Don't change a single thing about it. Amen. It might not fit your lifestyle. It might not fit your political agenda, but it's the Word of God no matter what. And it's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore, because He's the same yesterday, today and forevermore. We cannot change the Word of God. And so we really, really, really need to be honed in and careful of what we hear concerning the, and what we receive concerning the orating and the giving and the broadcasting of the Word of God. Amen? So we need to be careful about that, all right? In this series, we're in a series that we're winding down. We're winding down this series called Windows and Gates. And in it, we've been examining how to open and close the windows and gates in our lives. We've compared and contrasted metaphorical parallels to opening windows with great faith and solid belief in the power of God, to the actual parts of us that are our windows and gates, being the eyes and the heart, as well as examining the spiritual role of a watchman. We continue to seek to open that what has been shut to us and close that that has been left open, thereby making us vulnerable. And the final message for this series will be preached this Sunday. We are wrapping up Windows and Gates this Sunday, and we're preparing for Kingdom Vision. Amen? Are we ready to go a little bit deeper tonight than we did Sunday? Amen? Did anybody enjoy Sunday? Were you here? Did you see it online? Let's go a little bit deeper tonight. Father, we need you tonight as we communicate and present what you've given us to share tonight. God, may every hearer hone in on what thus saith the Lord tonight. Lord God, let them receive it in their hearts, and may it change their minds and change their lives and set their souls on fire for you, Jesus. That they would go out, Lord God, and change the atmosphere of where they are for the glory and the kingdom of you. In Jesus' holy name, somebody say amen three times. All right, look at your neighbor and say, did you say it three times? I only heard you say it twice, and he said three times. Okay. I want to recap, too. This past Sunday, we brought the fourth message from our series, Windows and Gates. And in it, we spoke of opening the windows and floodgates of heaven by adhering to instructional authority. Somebody say instructional authority. Jesus gives the instruction with authority. And if we receive that instruction, if we carry out that instruction, we are walking in his authority, right? Jesus gave it in what he said. He said, go into all the world, amen, and preach the gospel to every creature. Go into all the world. Now, you can't get on a plane tonight and go all over the world, but we can certainly support anybody that's willing to, amen? And we literally do that through, right now, there's people, I have people message me from third world countries that watch our broadcast online. So, amen, this little country church in Sandy Cross, North Carolina, somebody over in Pakistan, as well as Indonesia, want to hear what thus saith the Lord coming out of here. Amen? God can line anything up, right? There's no miles, there's no oceans that can separate what God wants to do. But also, we've got a gentleman by the name of Chance Walters, who pretty much, I look at his life sometimes and I say, wow. Amen? And it's not for me, but I have to, admit sometimes I look at all the places that he goes and I think to myself, what a life he is living. And those little kids, because one of them's a boy and two of them girls, right? Look at what they're getting to see growing up, going all over the world. And if Chance and his wife's name's Casey, right? If they're willing to do that, somebody needs to get behind them and help them. Amen? Hallelujah. So we're all about that. And so he said, go into all the world, preach the gospel. He said, heal the sick. He didn't say, hope the sick get well. He said, heal them. Right? Don't walk away saying, well, I hope it worked. I hope that worked. We just prayed and we splashed oil on their head and we spit all over everybody. I mean, Rhea, come on. I hope it worked. I mean, sometimes you, come on, have you ever felt that? Amen. It's almost like the person walks away from the altar and there's this meaning of, good luck, brother. I hope you make it. Faith tells me he's going to make it. I know he's going to make it. Amen. We've got to break that bondage off of that thing. Amen? There's a key we're missing. He said, go into all the world, preach the gospel, heal the sick. And here's the key right here. Seek first the kingdom of God. If we're not seeking first the kingdom of God, we don't need to expect nobody to get healed. If we're seeking our own materialism, our own secularism, our own worldlyism, our own ism in any kind of ism, amen, you don't need to expect a single thing. But if you're seeking his kingdom, amen, that don't mean you wake up sounding like an angel singing every morning, when you get up out of the bed. But I'm here to tell you, when your feet hit the floor, thank you, God, for another day. Lord God, thank you that I woke up alive this morning, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. Come on, somebody. I'm not in the ditch, poor, begging for bread, Lord God. But even if I was, you wouldn't forsake me. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, God, that I've lived to see another day. God, what can I do for you today? Everybody's always asking you to do something for them. God, what can I do for you today to make your kingdom come? Amen. Seek first the kingdom of God, he said. And then we said, our shouting point was, when we walk in what he said, we'll benefit fully from what he did, right? I don't want to benefit halfway. I don't want to benefit partially. I want to benefit fully, right? I've said it before, and I got to keep saying it. Being a Christian is not just about going to heaven when you die. Now, if it was about nothing but that, how many know that's enough? That's enough for me. Sign me up, right? I do not want to go where the worm dieth not and the fires are never quenched. That sounds awful. That sounds worse than anything Stephen King could ever come up with, right? I don't want to do that. But there's more. Jesus said, I have come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. Not that you might struggle. Not that you would wallow in depression. Not that you would let life beat you down every day and never see a victory. Jesus Christ wants us to have victories on a regular basis. And even when the world tries to give you trials and give you tribulations, he admitted you will have them. He said, but be of good cheer. I have overcome it. I've overcome it, right? Then we spoke of the gate that must be shut. What gate? Hell's gate. And we said that the gates of hell won't prevail over you when the floodgates of heaven are being opened up for you. Right? When Simon Peter declared Jesus the Christ, Jesus said he would build his church upon that. What's that? People who said what Simon Peter was saying. People who were displaying great faith like Simon Peter was. Meaning Jesus asked a point-blank question, and the disciples started saying what other folks said, right? And then Jesus got personal, and he got really direct. He said, well, what do you say? Peter's the only one that stood up, right? And he always was doing that, right? He's the only one that got out of the boat and walked on the water. But he's the one that said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And something that we didn't go over Sunday was the key to what he was saying. When he said, you are the Christ, when he was bold enough to say, you are the Messiah, you are the Christ, you are God in the flesh, right? You are the Son of the living God. You are a part of the Godhead. You are him who the prophecies promise. When he said that, Jesus said, you are the rock in which I shall build my church upon, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it, right? We all strive to do that. We all strive to be solid. That's what rock foundation is. It's solid. It's not shifting. It's solid. Our integrity ought to mean something to us, right? If you say you're going to do something, do it, right? I even thought about this, and I was going to post this a while ago, but I didn't have time. I need to get to church. Your integrity as a volunteer should be as important to you as your integrity is as an employee. Really? Whether you're getting paid or not, if you're representing God in anything, come on. Let your integrity mean something. If you said you'd do it, do it. If you said, come on, if you said you'd help, help. If you said you'd take a stand, take a stand. And so he says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus says, I can build my church upon people who are talking like you're talking. He was talking right. But then if you kept reading that portion of Scripture for Sunday, just a few verses later, Jesus started talking about going to the cross and dying for our sins, right? And then Peter started shouting him down and saying, no, Jesus, you're not going to die. He was enjoying being on tour with Jesus, right? I mean, that was a tour. Come on, somebody. Before the Beatles ever came to America, come on, somebody.
Before Elvis ever sold out Madison Square Garden or whoever, before Bon Jovi did Giant Stadium, there was Jesus Christ, and he was drawing crowds like nobody had ever drawn crowds, and Peter was liking the notoriety. He was loving the excitement that the crowds gave him. But Jesus said there's going to come a time when the crowds are all going to run, and it ain't going to be nobody left but me carrying a cross for you and all of them. And it sounded dreary. It sounded kind of doomy and gloomy, and he didn't like it because it was an end to the party. And a lot of times, ministry is not always happy. Ministry can be hard. Ministry can hurt you. Ministry can cause you pain. Ministry can cause you to miss a meal, not because you're fasting either. Amen. But Jesus said, I'm doing this because this is what I've been called to do. And the moment Peter started saying, no, he was speaking against Jesus' destiny. And what did Jesus have to do and say to the one he just called the rock that he could build his church upon? The gates of hell would not prevail against it. He said, he had to say, get behind me, Satan. That's how quick what we're saying can change things in our life. Amen? You could be speaking faith and solidarity and wholeness in 1 minute, and then in the next minute, just be speaking doubt and fear and intimidation and against destiny, and all of a sudden, you go from being the rock that Jesus can build a church upon and the gates can't prevail against you to being called Satan and having to be rebuked. I mean, I got to rebuke this because hell's trying to prevail against you right now and trying to attack me from what I'm doing, right? It changes that quick. And the gates of hell would not prevail. He says, we then ended by speaking of both spouses and young people. Did y'all like that? That was a little risky, but we went there because it's important. Amen. If you didn't hear it, you might want to go back and listen. Amen. And then you can say, is that preacher saying that? Yeah. The church has been quiet about it too long, and it's time. And preachers wouldn't have to preach it if the divorce rate wasn't higher in the church than it is in the world. So it's time for preachers to preach it. And come on, somebody. I don't care how many young people are in church. There's a lot of people in young people in church and still in trouble. Right? That's because there's a lot of adults that are in church, but they're not in Christ. There's a lot of young people over the age of accountability that are in church, but they're not in Christ. Right? And we got to recognize what the gateways of hell are in a young person's life and what is trying to pull them in. Amen? We need parents to be parents, not just buddies. We need them to be parents. And we need spouses to be covenant partners who are one. Who are one. Too many people operate marriages separately. It don't work. That's not what God designed marriage to be. Amen? You got to operate as one. All right, so tonight I want to continue on this message in opening what God has for us. Have you got Matthew 7 ready? Let's look at Matthew 7. Now again, back to the red letters of Jesus here in this portion of Scripture where he is teaching on the power of persistence. Somebody say persistence. He says in verse 7 of chapter 7 in Matthew, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and it will be open to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be open. Amen. I want you to go over that again and again in your spirit. Say it in your head till it gets in your heart. It will be open for me. It shall open for me. That thing that you need, that breakthrough that you need, you know what it would do for your life. It might not necessarily be a want, but it's a need. It's something that you really need to happen, whether it's a restoration, a reconciliation, a forgiveness, a repair to a relationship, whatever it is, whatever kind of breakthrough you need, say, it will be open to me. Verse 9 says, or what man is there among you who, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Amen?
I mean, come on. If your kid tells you they're hungry and they want something to eat, mama, you're gonna make them a sandwich at least, right? Or get them one of those little Lunchables or PB&J, right? I ain't had supper yet, y'all. I'm sorry. Some cheese and crackers, something. But you're not going to give them a stone, right? He says, if they ask for a fish, are you going to give them a serpent? No. He says in verse 11, if you then, being evil, what does he mean by that? If you then who are born in sin know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more? You need to look at that too. How much more? If I'm willing to do this for my kids, how much more is God willing to do for me? Come on now. He's always, look how good you are to your children. Anybody in here will admit, come on, you bless them. Anybody got grandchildren? You spoil them, right? I was in the Dollar General yesterday, Pastor Tim. I saw some little toys in there, and I was told that B-Bug wanted a good boy yesterday. But because I was there and I saw that, I wanted to still get him something. And Tiffany said, no, Maria said he was not good today. I said, I want to give him something. And I was like, well, I don't need to be giving him nothing if he got in trouble today, right? Man, I wanted to bless him. I wanted to bless him because, I mean, that's, you know, it's for my son and my daughter-in-law to take care of all the discipline. When he comes to my house, we're just, you know, I did my discipline years with my two boys. With him, it's just, what do you want, baby? What can I do for you? What, you know, oh, you were a bad boy today? All right, well, yeah, you can go swimming. I mean, you're at Poppy's house now. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? Right? Point blank. Does this not confirm that he wants to bless you? Stop thinking that God don't want to bless you. If you think that you stand a 50-50 chance as a Christian at getting blessed on a regular basis by God, here's the thing. You have religion, you do not have a relationship with Jesus. Because to know him as Father is to know him as Blesser. Right? Can I give you a teaching point real quick? Watch this. You cannot know God as a true Father unless you truly know he is the one who wants to truly bless your life. Right? I know that's not rocket science right there, but it's good. It's good to me. Amen? He wants to bless your life. He wants to bless your life. You cannot know God as a true Father. And the reason I said true Father is because some people may physically be a father, but they're not a true father. I mean, really, there's a lot of people that are fathers out there. I'm talking about a true father. I'm talking about a father that lays his life down for his children. I'm talking about a father, a dad that puts his kids before himself, right? That's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about a father who is present in his children's lives, whether or not him and their mother are still married, right? You have to be clear about that, amen, in this day and time. You have to tell people what a true father is because for a lot of people, father means a whole lot of different things, right? But a true father, amen, man that would lay his life down for his family, a man that would teach his children, love his children, put his children first, a true father. Listen, that's what God is, the truest father that could ever be. He is the heavenly Father. He is the Father of all. Amen? There's no truer Father than God. He authored the definition of a true Father. Amen? So don't think for one minute that God don't want to bless your life. To know him as Father is to know him as Blesser. Amen? All right. So keep knocking. It will be open unto you. Let me get to the next scripture, Revelation 3. You might say, oh, Revelation, you're going into Revelation? We're going to be here for a while. No, we're just going to glance at it real quick and we'll be done. Not here to give you an expository Bible study or an expository teaching. I want to look at something real quick that I saw in here. Loved it, wanted to share it with you. Is that all right? Revelation 3, when it comes to the solidarity of what the Lord opens for us and closes for us, I'm reminded of what Jesus' revelation showed John the Apostle in a heavenly, eternal vision concerning the church, concerning Christians who are faithful. Somebody said faithful. in their belief, faithful in their servanthood, and faithful in their life unto God. Real quick, seven churches at that time in history are addressed, right? There's seven churches that are addressed in the book of Revelation where John is about 90 years old. He's on the island of Patmos. He survived being martyred. All the apostles, that especially all the ones that served under Jesus as disciples, they were all martyred, including John. Only difference is John lived through it. They dropped him into a hot pot of boiling oil, and he survived. He severely burned all over. They say, well, let's just put him in prison for the rest of his life. At 90 years old, he has this vision, amen, and he sees Jesus. He talks to Jesus, and Jesus shows him the apocalypse of the world, the end times, all right? He sees a lot of symbolism, but I want you to see what he sees right here towards the beginning of the book in Revelation 3. There's seven churches that are addressed here at this time in history. The last two categorize the two lasting states of churches from then to now. What are those? Faithful and lukewarm. Philadelphia, the church of Philadelphia was faithful. The church of Laodicea was lukewarm. That is still the state of churches today. They're either one or of two kinds of churches. You either got a faithful church or you got a lukewarm church. You got a church also, watch this, with a mixture of faithful people and lukewarm people. So it could be the whole church is faithful or the whole church is lukewarm, or it could be a church that has a mixture of faithful people and lukewarm people. Because a church is not just a building or an establishment, it is the people, right? Okay. And so, Jesus says in verse 7, and to the angel of the church in Philadelphia, write, these things says he who is holy, he who is true, he who has the key of David, he's talking about himself, this is Jesus, he who opens and no one shuts, and shuts and no one opens. You need to know that Jesus is going ahead and setting the record straight from the get-go. Jesus says, if I open it, nobody can shut it unless I say shut it. If I shut it, nobody can open it back up again. Can I go ahead and tell some people that are still beating themselves up because of their past? If Jesus shut it, come on somebody, let it stay shut. I don't care who tries to attack your life and say, how in the world could you have ever done that? How could you have ever fell into that? You have to just answer and say, yes, that was bad, but Jesus shut the door on my past. I am a new creation through Christ Jesus. Come on, he shut it. Now you need to shut it. Come on here. Come on here. Amen. Hallelujah. Verse 8, watch this. I know your works. Everybody says, that's like a bad word in Christianity, works, works, works. And I get it. Some people are really focused on work instead of worship. They really are. And that's a problem. Amen. And as pastors, when we see that, we're going to intercede. And we're going to say, hey, look, come on, put the work down and start worshiping. Amen. Come on. Amen. The church has to function. The church needs the different roles that people do. I get that. In the day and time that we have now, we got to have people that are watchful. We got folks in here that when I say bow your heads and pray, they can't do that. Amen. But at the same time, we don't never need to forsake our ability and our responsibility to be worshipers, right? He says, I know your works. I see what you've done. He says, see, I've set before you an open door, and no one can shut it. For you have a little strength, have kept my word, and have not denied my name. Indeed, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who say they are Jews. These were persecutors at this time. Jewish people were persecuting Christians, right? And are not, but lie. Indeed, I will make them come and worship before your feet, and to know that I have loved you. At that time, they were acting as they were better. They were holier. They were elite. And he was saying, don't worry about that. Because we know in the Bible that eventually every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess, right? In fact, when the rapture takes place, there's going to be 144,000 Jews who get so fired up when they realize that Jesus really was the Messiah and that he has come in the rapture really was true and it has happened, they're going to preach like nobody has ever preached before. Amen? And they're not going to worry about denominational differences. They're not going to worry about nothing. They are going to preach the fire of God on this earth, and the devil can't touch none of them. And they're going to have crusades like you would never believe during the seven-year tribulation, despite the fact that the world is being run by a madman. You think about that, okay? But he says to those of the church, he says to the Christians, and I believe it's prophetic to you and I today, not to just them at that time. He says, because you have kept my command to persevere, that's so important, to persevere. Somebody say persevere. That means you got every reason in the world to quit, but you don't. You got every reason in the world to give up by now, but you haven't. I also will keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. Now, the persecution of Christians did spread all over the world. It did. But when he's talking about the hour of trial, I believe, and many scholars believe, he is talking about, because really, prophecy works like this. It can be talking about one thing at that time, and it can shift to hundreds and hundreds of years, 1,000 years, 2,000 years into the future, right? He says, I will also keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. That's the tribulation. Anybody that is preaching, we are in a tribulation right now, because of COVID-19, needs to read their Bible. When you are staying at home a lot, not eating out or whatever, and you're binge-watching Netflix, you are not in the Great Tribulation. I mean, come on. So it tells me here he's going to keep us from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. He says in verse 11, and I'm done, behold, I am coming quickly. Hold fast what you have, that no one may take your crown. Meaning you've got to be responsible with this thing. Now, some would say he's talking about people backsliding to the point of not being saved anymore. Some would say crown represents the reward you have in heaven when you show up. You don't want to show up to the party empty-handed. Either way, he says, behold, I come quickly. Hold fast what you have. I'm here to tell you right now, there's a lot of people. I ain't saying they ain't saved, but they sure are backing up on some Bible. They are backing up on some Bible to get what they want, to get their story across, to get their point across. They're backing up on a lot of things. And we need to be careful in this day and time. I know the church looks a little different. And we dress a little different. And we are going after the world. We're going after young people. Amen. We're doing all these things to keep the church modernized and keep the church in the conversation so we can reach the whole world. Amen. We're preaching substance, and we need to be seeing people getting saved and baptized on a regular basis. We need to be seeing that, but not to the point that we sell our souls, not to the point that, come on somebody, that we sound more like somebody that don't know what they're talking about anymore. Can I tell you, Jesus is still the King, and what he said in that word never fails. It never fails. Come on somebody. Come on. I had a rough and wild background, so when you see me pray, I used to just... Come on, I used to jump up and down and shout to the devil. So I'm going to shout to my Lord. Amen? I'm going to shout. Amen? You can think what you want to about it. If I want to run, I'm going to run. Amen? Amen? Don't call me a performer. I'm not a performer. I'm a praiser. Amen? Hallelujah. And my praise song might sound different than your praise song. I might look over there at Steve, amen, and say, play me a little Eddie Van Halen solo in that thing. But don't you think that me and Steve don't love some Jesus Christ, amen?
But at the same time, I'm not backing up on what that Bible said to fit any political agenda, any political party. Come on, somebody. The Word of God still stands. Amen. I can't help it if Pastor so-and-so said that. We got people backing up. We got men of God saying that abortion lines up with Christianity. The devil is a liar. The devil is a liar. God despises the shed blood of the innocent. Come on. God despises the redefining of marriage. Marriage is between a man and a woman. I can't help whose feelings it hurts. I love everybody. I welcome everybody. I will pray for anybody, minister to anybody. I will show up at your doorstep in the middle of the night. I don't care if you're gay or transgender. But at the same time, amen, I'm not the one that needs to change. You will not change me. Help me, God. Amen. My God, I look out there, and it's just getting crazier and crazier. And I want to just look at people and say, you are a man of God. Don't do this. Don't do this. Amen. I don't care if they line your pockets. I don't care what they do. I don't care if they put you on TV. I don't care if it gives you fortune and fame. I don't care if it gives you notoriety. If you sell your whole soul for the world that you're gaining, you're going to lose it. Jesus said you'll lose it. I don't want to gain the whole wide world and lose my soul. Amen? I'm getting off the subject. I'm sorry. I know we got to baptize. But I got it. He said, behold, I come quickly. Hold fast to what you have that no one may take your crown. Here we see our Christianity can be damaged by faltering. Amen? And I don't know about you. I'm not going to let nobody take a single crown. And I don't know if anything I've done since I've been a Christian is good enough to even have a crown in heaven one day. I just want to make it. I want to make it to his feet. And I just want to say, Lord, I'm home. Amen. But if there's a crown he wants me to have so that I can lay at his feet while I'm there, I don't want to lose it now, Brother Eddie. Listen, the open door is the ultimate one right here. The open door is the ultimate one. It's called rapture. We're talking about things opening and closing in this series, right? Windows and gates. The ultimate opening is the rapture. The closed door, the closed window, the closed gate is avoiding the seven-year tribulation. He has closed it for you and I. I know there's people out there that believe in mid-tribulation. I am a pre-tribulation rapture believer. The rapture will trigger the last 7 years upon earth as we know it. And whether I go to heaven supernaturally in the rapture or naturally by death, amen, I will avoid the seven-year tribulation because my Lord has opened a way that no devil and no man can shut. Amen? Hallelujah. Give me that last teaching point. No matter what comes of this world, the Lord has opened up an escape that no one can close. No matter what happens to it. When you look at the world right now, you get scared. You don't know what to believe. You see violent riots. You see police shootings. You see people dying. You see young men dying. Amen. We see children dying. Come on, somebody. And come on, you want to be right in my eyes? Speak out against all of it, not just some of it. All of it, not just some of it. Amen? Hallelujah. I'm tired of everybody being separated and our outrage is separated and divided because of color. I'm only outraged if the person is white. I'm only outraged if the person is black. What is God outraged about? He's outraged by one color, and that's blood red. Because that's what every black person and every white person and every brown person and every yellow person bleed. We all bleed red. Amen? And the only way out of this crazy place is if we let our blood, our red blood, be injected by his blood, the blood of Jesus that ran down the cross over 2,000 years ago, that you and I may have life and have it more abundantly. Amen? Gosh. I'm trying to have a Bible study, Sister Gladys. We can't have selective outrage. Amen. I'm outraged by all of it. I'm outraged by all of it. As I close tonight, if I can, may we open what blesses our lives and close what curses our lives. Amen. I want blessings opened unto me and curses closed. I don't want to curse. Come on, somebody. I don't want to curse in any part of my life. I don't want to curse in my family. I don't want to curse in my body. I don't want to curse in my ministry. I don't want to curse in my home. I don't want to curse in my finances. Amen? People walking around with curses when the Word of God has given us instructional authority of how to push back the curses, yet we won't do what the Word of God says, and then we wonder why we're cursed. Well, we're going to talk about it Sunday. Y'all pray for me as I get ready to talk about everything Sunday. Keep knocking. Keep persevering. Keep believing Him fully. Keep trusting Him completely. Keep His Word and never deny His name. Don't deny His name. Don't be afraid to talk about Him. Hallelujah. His name is Jesus. His name is love. His name is victory. His name is glory. Hallelujah. I love His name. As the old song says, there's just something about that name. Amen. Hallelujah. As the old song says, there's victory in Jesus, my Savior, forever. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. Love has a name. His name is Jesus. And what He has opened up for you and I, no man can shut. I'm so glad of that. So I want you to know there's a way out. It's called the rapture, and if you go in death, naturally, accidentally, or intentionally, guess what? The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Amen. Isn't that so comforting? Hallelujah. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Father, we pray tonight. If there be any online tonight that does not know You as Lord and Savior, or any in this room right now, with every head bowed and every eye closed, Lord God, that they would let it be known. Online, they would say, I want to be saved. In big, bold letters, in all caps, I want to be saved. And we will contact them and baptize them next Wednesday night. If you're here in this room right now and you've never asked Jesus into your heart, and you want that open gate, that open window, that open door that no man can shut called the rapture. You can't have that unless you belong to Jesus. If that's you, raise your hand very quickly in this room. Anybody at all? Anybody at all? Anybody at all? Anybody at all? Amen. Hallelujah. And Father, I pray that if there's anybody right now that needed to raise their hand, or anybody online that needed to put in all caps, I want to be saved, Lord God, they would let this seed flourish and they would not wait too much longer at all before they let somebody know that they want their name to be added to the Lamb's Book of Life. Hallelujah. In Jesus' holy name. Is that all right tonight? Can we give God the praise tonight? Hallelujah. I don't know if the kids went on a trip. I don't know if they went. They did go somewhere. Okay. All right, so we won't be bringing them back in then. Hallelujah. If there's any to bring back in, you can. There are some. Okay. Go get them then. And we've got a prayer request here. All right. We're going to go over some prayer requests real quick. Oh, man, is this all this right here and this? Okay, y'all kick back and grab a pack of naps. Amen. All right, let's see. Ray Lee Overton, newborn baby, is having breathing issues. That baby to be able to breathe tonight in the matchless name of Jesus. Bonnie White is in the hospital with pneumonia, colon cancer, and lung issues. We want
her to be healed in the name of Jesus. Angela Green, she visits with us sometimes. She's recovering from double bypass surgery. Amen. And we're believing that she's feeling better already. Already. Kathy Whitley, this is Phyllis Murray's sister, has had a stroke. We are believing for the restoration of that. Amen.
Amen.
We've had people in this church, some of our seniors, that have had a stroke before and they were totally restored. Amen. And we're believing for that. Jackie Coley, kidney cancer. We rebuke cancer in the name of Jesus. Amen. The Daniels family is asking for prayers tonight. Amen. And Carol Edmondson is asking for continued prayer tonight. All right. Amen. Stephanie Metzger is having surgery September 3rd. Amen. We'll be lifting her up. And also Bonnie White is in ICU. We've got that right here. Amen. So we're lifting up Bonnie White. We're lifting up Stephanie. Amen. As Stephanie's watching from home, won't Stephanie know we miss her and we love her. Amen. Hallelujah. Michael Blackmer, his father-in-law is battling cancer, and he is a pastor. Amen. And so I rebuke that in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Yes. Pastor Donnie Baker, we claim his healing tonight in the matchless name of Jesus. Amen. Also, Tina Hitchpeth, David, and Lisa Davis, they are praying for, they're in the hospital. They both have pneumonia. We're praying for them. Vicki Graham, we're giving a praise report. She had a family member that was tested for COVID-19 that came back negative. Amen. Getting reports like that all the time, too, of people who are coming back and their tests are coming back negative. Also, someone right here that's been in a car accident, we need to lift them up. Mary Atkins, this is Tina's mom. She's hospitalized. Not sure she will be able to have surgery to remove another spot from her lungs. And that's scheduled for this Friday. I want to say, is Tina in the room? She in the room? She did have lung cancer on one lung. They got it off. Now it's on the other. And so we're going to believe that she'll be strong enough to have this surgery as well. Amen? Because just like God made a way before, he'll make a good way again. Amen. He done it before, he'll do it again. Kim Lane, this is, she's asking prayer for Christian Barnes. He was burned over half his body. I don't know how old this person is. It might be a young person, I don't know, but we're lifting him up. Tracy Daniels, keep her husband in prayer for a few procedures that he's having tomorrow morning. Amen. And we certainly will. We're going to lay all this right here. We're going to ask that you reach your hands out in faith towards these. Amen. How many of you in the seats tonight, you have something you're believing God for? Amen. You're trusting him right now. Trust him in faith right now along with these. Father, we are trusting you, and we are believing, Lord God, by the power of your name, by the authority of your name, by the anointing of your healing, Lord God. We are believing for breakthroughs for every single one that was mentioned and those not mentioned on this list. For those that are in the audience tonight lifting their hands in faith to intercede on behalf of those that were mentioned, Lord God, but they themselves have a great need that they need you to move upon in. Lord God, we know that you are doing it, Lord, right now. Let them know, Lord God, it has been open for them and nothing can shut it, Lord God. They are receiving breakthroughs. We are believing for surgeries to go well. We are believing for people to be healed of pneumonia, COVID-19, Lord God, cancer. Lord God, whatever it is, Lord Jesus, we know that you're guiding the hands of surgeons that will work on people this week. And God, we are asking for mighty, mighty breakthroughs in these families. Lord God, in the lives of those that are here tonight in person or online, God. God, those that have upcoming surgeries, Lord God, give them peace tonight. We praise you, Lord God, and we look to you for all things, Lord God. You are the hope of glory.
Yes.
The author and the finisher of our faith, God. We love you, and we are honored, Lord God, to serve you, Jesus. Amen. Praise your holy name. Pastor Tim, I want you to share with the people. I probably should have got you to pray, but here's what we're going to do. First off, is there a microphone over there with Anthony? Okay. I know young Daniel's going to want to pray over his uncle getting baptized tonight, so he'll use that mic tonight later on. But right now, I'm going to go get ready, okay? Sister Gladys is going to go ahead and get the people who are being baptized. I want you to just extend a little bit on what we talked about tonight as far as the way, the open way God has given us through rapture. Amen. As well as when we ask, we knock. Amen. It shall be open to us. And what God opens, no man can shut. Talk a little bit about that. Then come on up there with me after I get in the water. I just need about 3 or 4 minutes to change into my Superman suit. Amen. And then we're going to go. But those that are being baptized can come on up. Go with Sister Gladys. She's going to show you everything to do. And we'll be back in a minute. Can we give it up for the greatest assistant pastor on the planet?
Amen. Can I stand up? Yeah, you made me want to preach this message all over again. Awesome word, awesome word. And God truly gave me some insight on what you preach. It's such an awesome word. But God began to minister to me even as he was talking, because I think one of the biggest problems of us as believers, we don't see ourselves as God sees us. We have to learn to see ourselves as God. I was thinking about a scripture in Romans. It's, I beseech you by the mercies of God, that you present your body living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is our reasonable service. It said, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of our minds. And a lot of times what happens is when we mess up, we fall back into those old ways. How many remember when the children of Israel came out of Egypt? Y'all remember that? What did they begin to say when things got hard? Let's go back to Egypt. And that's what we do a lot of time as believers. When stuff get hard or when we miss the mark, we digress and go back the opposite way. But we are children of the Most High God. We can never forget that. The enemy always try to distract us and make us think, well, there hasn't been a change. Huh? I'm my same old self. The Bible declares that all things become new, but it's progressive. We're continuing to walk in it each and every day. When we fall, we got to get back up and keep moving forward. Huh? We got a heaven to reach, and we got some folks to reach on the way to heaven. But if we never see ourselves as God sees us, ah, my God. I'm reminded of when God spoke to me, and it wasn't in church. That what was so mind-blowing about it. I was in a prison, and he spoke to me. And he said, I called you to preach. And I kept saying, I can't, I'm messed up. It's no way you can be talking about me. But he was. And guess what I found out? It was a gate and a doorway into the things that he had for me. And that's the same with each and every one of us. He said, I know the thoughts and the plans that I have for you, thoughts of good and not evil, and to give you an expecting end. How many want their expecting end? Huh? Start seeing yourself as God see you. If you don't know how to see yourself, ask him. Huh? Didn't he just say it? Knock. Ask, and it shall be given unto you. Knock, and the door shall be open. It's some things that God want to bring into our lives. But if we don't get it when we want it, guess what we stop doing? We stop asking, and then when he tells us to knock, we stop knocking, because it ain't on our time. We can't stop knocking. We can't stop asking. And I didn't. See, I can testify about my own life, because I understand that it's real. And when I miss it, guess what I do? It's just like a parent. When your children miss it, guess what you don't do? You don't throw them away. He don't throw us away. Now, I might get out of fellowship, but I never out of relationship. Amen. This is a relationship. How many are ready for the baptism? The man of God is ready. Take that word. Don't take that word lightly, because that word will change your life. Am I right about it? Come on, let's have some baptism.
Amen. Again, thank you so much for being here tonight. Amen. And it's always a wonderful, wonderful occasion when we get the opportunity to do this. And Pastor Tim's going to come in just a moment. He's going to help our first contestant come down the steps there. And the water's not all that, it's not all that cold, amen, but it's not all that warm either, but it's kind of just right, amen. I've seen it before be real cold, and I've seen it before be real hot, amen. So we got a little bit of both here. But as I said, never grow tired.
Yes.
Of good things happening.
Yes.
In a church where people and their lives are changing. I don't know if you saw it when you pulled into the road here on Lewis Road, but on the side of the church now, we've got lives change here.
Yes.
And that's true. My life changed here.
Come on, Pastor.
Amen. And the last Sunday of 2004, my life changed for the better. Doesn't mean I didn't ever have problems. Doesn't mean I didn't ever make mistakes or commit sin.
Come on,
but
Pastor.
But my life got better. Changed here as well. Amen. Speaking of one, first person tonight is Joey Blackmer. Y'all let him know you love him tonight. Oh, Joey is Big Mike's brother, and so that explains a little bit of what we see here, all right? His arms are bigger than mine, all right? But anyway, Joey came two Sundays in a row. He's a businessman. He's a private business owner. The American dream, own your own business, amen? And we want his business to be blessed, flourish and yes. Increase, but no matter what, he's a child of God, man. Oh. And we're so thankful for him. And tonight, as we prepare to baptize him, his nephew Daniel wants to pray over his baptism. So Daniel, you go ahead and pray over your Uncle Joey's baptism tonight. Go ahead, son.
Father, I pray for Joey's baptism tonight. I pray for anything the enemy tries to keep him from God, Lord. Just let him remain faithful to you and let him know that he doesn't need to lose hope, that he needs to keep pushing towards you, Lord. And bless him and just keep him safe and bless him as he's doing his baptism tonight. I thank you for blessing his lost soul, Lord. I thank you for blessing him and I thank you for saving him, Lord. And I thank you for everything you do. And I thank you for him being baptized and him being saved. And we love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Jesus sent out of the mouth of babes comes perfected praise. Amen. Hallelujah. That was some good stuff right there. Yes. All right, Joe, you ready for this? When you go down, you can come back up by just pulling on that rail, okay? Makes it a little easier on me, but I will pull you up if I have to. But listen, don't be nervous about a thing. I know how to do this because I am
a professional.
All right, you ready? Joey, I'm about to baptize you in the name of Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost, I baptize you.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Come on, give God a praise. Some noise.
Bibler's sister. Email, 1, 2, 3, just like that. And that just, it shows you an old saying that my pastor used to say, sheep begat sheep.
Yes.
And what that means is when somebody sees how much you love Jesus, they're going to want to have what you have. Another, okay, now that's a super spiritual analogy that Pastor Jerry used to give. Now I'm going to give you just a plain layman's term analogy he used to give. And that is when they see you licking the ice cream cone, they're not going to want it if you take the ice cream cone and smear it in their face. They're not going to want anything to do with your ice cream or you. But if you just keep licking the ice cream cone and showing them how good that ice cream is, eventually, you know what they're going to say? I want some ice cream. Amen? And so Carlos and Courtney, hallelujah,
yes,
were licking the ice cream cone in front of Amber. And she said, you know what? I want some of that spiritual ice cream.
Hey!
Amen. So with that said, you said you were 21. You're the oldest one then, aren't you? You're the oldest one.
Yes, the
amen. Lord. And, you know, at 21, I'll tell you this, I want nowhere near the church.
Good.
Amen. I want nowhere near the Lord. I knew I needed him, but I was running from him.
Yes.
And it would be 7 years later before I would ever surrender. I want to tell you in this day and time and what this generation, because you're considered a millennial, what the millennials are facing and what they're being approached with, it's difficult. It's difficult,
yes,
to pull away from that.
It is.
But can I tell you how proud we are of you,
yes,
and the stand you've taken for Jesus?
Hey!
So thank you so much, Amber. And it's not always going to be easy, but it will be better.
Yes.
The attacks are going to come. They're going to come in your life. They're going to come in your head. All kinds of things that'll try to make you regret what you have done here. But if you'll hold on to Jesus, amen,
yes,
he will never let you down.
Never.
People will let you down. Christians will let you down.
Yes.
Jesus will never let
Jesus
you down. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. Well, come on, somebody. Amen. I just had a great idea. I want somebody to pray that's not prayed in the church yet, but I know in my heart they are ready to pray. And that's Pam Johnson.
Hey!
I want you to pray over this young lady.
Hallelujah!
I want you to pray over Amber's baptism tonight. Go ahead, woman of God. Take you down and bring you back up, and you can pull yourself up. But if you don't, I'll get you up, okay? And don't worry about a thing, because I am a
professional.
All right, are we ready? All right, Amber, I baptize you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. I baptize you.
Hey!
Give God a praise. Now, we got her mama.
Woo!
This is Doris. Say, hey, Doris.
Hey, Doris.
Hallelujah. She is the mother of Carlos, Courtney, and Amber. Yes. And that just, I think that is just wonderful. Yeah. Amen. Amen. The kids come. They hear something about Jesus. They give their hearts to Jesus. They go home. They tell Mama about it. Mama comes to see what all the fuss is about. Jesus gets a hold of Mama's heart, and she gets saved, too. I just think that's a wonderful story. Wonderful story. Amen. Hallelujah. That's better than anything Hallmark Channel can give you right there. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, Doris, we're so proud of you, so proud of your family.
Yes.
Keep on keeping on. The word tonight was for you. Keep persevering. Keep pushing through. And to persevere is to keep going even when you want to quit.
Come on, Pastor.
Even when you want to stop, even when you may question, what is this all for? Amen. It is all worth it. Amen. Living for Jesus is worth it.
Yes.
I lived 28 long years without him. I'm so glad that I've lived the last almost 17 with him. Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So thank you for saying yes to the Lord. Amen.
Yes.
All right. We're going to get somebody to pray over your baptism. Amen. Hallelujah. Can I get somebody to raise your hand? Amen. Carlos, I was thinking so. I was thinking so. Amen. I was thinking so. But I didn't want to put a young person on the spot like I just did paint. Amen. But I'm glad he wants to do it. So now, how great is it that her son wants to pray over her baptism? Carlos, come around here beside us. Pastor Tim, we're about to see you. Amen. Hallelujah. Pray over your mother's baptism, my brother.
Dear Lord, yes. I pray for this moment right now for my mother for her baptism.
Yes.
I pray that you guide her with whatever your will is, dear Lord. Pray that you guide her in life as she learns your message. As she comes to church, just pray, God, please, God, guide her in her life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's all it takes. All right, just like that. You come up, grab that right there. You ready? Don't worry about a thing, because I am a
professional.
Here we go. All right, Doris, I baptize you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, the name of the Father, Son, Holy Ghost. I baptize you. Hallelujah. You got it. You good. You good. You good. Come on, give God a prayer. Stand to your feet. And if we're all about him, we got to be all about them.
That's
amen.
Right.
When you see them in the cafe, when you see them in the lobby, let them know how proud you are of them
yes.
in the oncoming weeks. Amen.
Amen.
This is just the beginning. Revival's already here. Amen.
Yes,
hallelujah. Let's keep having revival. I hope you enjoyed the Bible study. Come back Sunday morning for the finale of this incredible series. Amen.
Amen.
Father, thank you for this night. Thank you for these new believers. Thank you for the word that's gone forth. Thank you for the time that's been sown in our young people, Lord God. And God, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for every person here in this room and watching online. We look forward to being back here Sunday morning, Lord God, if you so should tarry. In Jesus' holy name, in the church said amen.
Amen.
Let our handicapped, elderly and immune deficient go first, and the rest of you can go. God bless you. We'll see you soon.